Okay. Welcome, everyone. Can you all hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Oh, yes, we can.
Yes, we can hear you.
Good afternoon.
Good day, everyone. I think we have quite a number of people here. We have quite a number of people here for this event. So I think we can start up. It is 4 minutes past 3 p.m. So this is a good start. Good day, everyone. We are glad to have you all here at this remarkable event this afternoon. It's a beautiful and bright day here in Lagos, Nigeria. And I would think it is the same with every other location. You are welcome to the launch and first edition of the Bandele and Folasade Foundation Lecture Series. My name is Chukwurah. I'm one of your hosts and anchor for today. And with me to co-host this event are Mr. Fuja Abadin and Mr. Ademola Oyebode. We promise you an hour and a half fulfilled afternoon, packed with lots of information from our well-seasoned professionals who have taken time out to prepare for this event. And you would also get to know what this foundation, Bandele and Folasade Toye Foundation, is all about. So sit back, grab a drink of your choice, and enjoy the ride with us this afternoon. So at this point, I think we are set to begin. So I would like to start this event with an opening prayer, which will be handled by Mr. Joshua Esson. Mr. Joshua Esson, please take the screen.
Good afternoon, everybody. Please just bow our heads for prayers. I know that our fellow, thank and appreciate you for this afternoon. We thank you for helping us to be able to put this together and for the grace for each and every one of us to be in attendance. Father, we say to you be the glory in Jesus' name. Lord, we are praying and committing everything that we get to do on this event this afternoon to your holy hands. We pray, Lord, that you make each and every activity a successful and a productive one in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for the answered prayers. For in Jesus' name we have prayed.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Yep. Okay. A very big thank you to Mr. Joshua Esson for that brief and wonderful prayer to kick off this great event. As earlier mentioned by Okpayemi Toye, my name is Fuja Abedin, and I'll be co-piloting this event alongside Okpayemi Toye and Ademola Oyebode for the next 1.5 hours thereabout. On behalf of the Bandele and Folasade Toye Foundation, I welcome everybody once again to this unique and wonderful event that marks the launch and first edition of the Bandele and Folasade Toye Foundation Lecture Series. This particular event is geared towards creating awareness on the mental health of the child and also to educate the public and specifically the youth on personal finance wellness. As earlier mentioned, we have in our midst our well-seasoned professionals who will be doing justice to these topics in a bit. But before I call on our first speaker, allow me to introduce to us one of the trustees of the Bandele and Folasade Toye Foundation to give us the opening address. Please help me welcome Mr. Oyeleke Toye as he gives us the opening address. Mr. Toye Oyeleke, sir, you have the screen.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Fuja. Good afternoon, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I'm honored to welcome you to the first edition of the Bandele and Folasade Toye Foundation Lecture Series. The children of any nation are its future, a country, a movement, a person that does not value his youth and children does not deserve his future. These are the words of Oliver Tambo, former president of the African National Congress, South Africa. My name is Oyeleke Toye, and I agree with these words of Oliver Tambo and those of John F. Kennedy when he said that children are the living messages we send to a time we will not see. Children represent the future of every family, every village, every country, and the human race. They are indeed our future. If we desire a brighter future for our country and our world, then not only must we pay attention to the children's physical health, which is the obvious one, we must see to their mental health and wellness. Unfortunately, very little or nothing is known about child mental health by a large percentage of adults in Africa and Nigeria in particular. Today, our guest speaker, the good doctor, will enlighten us on this very important topic and our role as adults in seeing to the mental health of our children and all the children of our country and our world. As we know, the fate of our world lies in the hands of our children, and we, the adults, have been entrusted with shaping the way our children turn out. It is our responsibility as adults and parents to provide the care required to produce well-rounded children. And this care comes at a cost, a considerable financial cost. The Bandele and Folasade Toye Foundation seeks to contribute to making a better society through a focus on child mental health and personal financial wellness. Today, we will also have a seasoned personal wealth expert and entrepreneur speak to us on how to achieve and maintain personal financial wellness. And on behalf of my siblings and our parents, Mr. Dele Olawoye Toye and Mrs. Folasade Francisca Toye, in whose names and honor this foundation has been set up, the members of Board of Trustees and all members of the foundation, I invite you to join us on this noble mission.
One more in here.
Borrowing from the words of Mother Teresa, we know only too well that what we are doing is nothing more than a drop in the ocean. But if the drop were not there, the ocean would be missing something. Let us all contribute our drop in the ocean as we seek to achieve the foundation's slogan, making a better you. Be healthy, be wealthy. And that is making a better me. Be healthy, be wealthy. Welcome and thank you again for joining us today. And finally, I am tempted to, to start to mention the names and the praises of the people, the good people who have worked very hard to bring this foundation into being. But then that would be at the expense of achieving the main aim of this foundation, which is making a better you, be healthy, be wealthy, child mental health, and personal financial wellness. So with that, I would leave the floor for the anchors to move us into the meat of the event. Thank you and welcome, and thank you again for joining us.
Right. Thank you so much, Mr. Toye, for that eye-opening address that has given a clearer picture to the vision, the purpose, and the objective upon which the foundation is based. Without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, we shall be moving to the first keynote address of the day. Before I call on the first speaker, however, I would love to inform us that there will be question and answer session time, you know, a question and answer session after each lecture of the day, please. I want to try as much as possible to accommodate one or two questions, you know, as the time permits. Thank you. Right about now, please join me as I make welcome our first speaker, the Registrar, Neuropsychiatric Hospital, Yaba, in person of which is one of the many challenges of child mental health. Thank you. Dr. Gbadegesin's lecture. Sorry. Dr. Gbadegesin.
I'm here. Good afternoon. Right. Yes, I'm just waiting.
Welcome.
Yes. You have the screen. There we go. All right. Okay. So, good afternoon once again. Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to speak. I know some information has been there about me, but let me just introduce myself again. I'm Dr. Gbadegesin Adebimpe Olamide, currently a resident doctor at the Federal Neuropsychiatric Hospital, Yaba. I have worked there for almost 2 years, and yes, I'm from Oyo State. I studied in Nizhny Novgorod State Medical University, Russia. I finished in 2018, January, so that's about 4 years ago. Anyways, so mental health is really my passion. That's why you find me where I am today. That's the reason why I chose to do psychiatry, to specialize in psychiatry. And today, I had to ask also, will I be speaking to, you know, medical professionals? And the person was like, no. I'm like, okay, fine. Let me not make my presentation too complicated with, you know, medical jargon and all that. So I've tried to simplify it to just give us, you know, a general idea of what we are dealing with. Sorry, if I along the line you can't hear me, just, you know, call my attention in case my internet breaks or something. So the topic is child mental health, like that's the general topic. And then I would talk about autism, which is one of the things that children suffer from in terms of mental health. So next slide, please. Okay, so this will be my outline, the introduction, epidemiology, definition, causes, how it presents, like how do you know a person has this illness, and my conclusion. Next slide, please. Okay, sorry, this can't, okay, maybe it's from my side. 1 second, I think I need to adjust. Okay, great. Yeah, so definition of mental health. There is no mental health without health, really. And mental health is the state of well-being in which an individual realizes his or her own abilities, can cope with the normal stresses of life, can work productively and fruitfully, is able to make contributions to his or her community according to the World Health Organization. So that now brings the question, does that mean that a person who doesn't know his or her ability, a person who can't cope with the stresses of life, a person who is not productive generally to the society, does that mean that person is mentally ill? Next slide, we'll find out along the line. Can I have the next slide, please?
and
I think okay, they
check that.
It has frozen.
Yeah, so
okay.
Slide four. Yeah, so just to give you like an overview of what mental health really is, because to majority in this part of the world, it's a myth, you know, and you would agree with me that a lot of people suffering from mental illnesses, you don't find them in the hospitals. You either find them in prayer houses, like churches, mosques, tied down, you know, being given so many, you know, strange things to drink, having to fast for days, you know. So that's how we see it, but it's actually very far from what we think it is. So really about 1 in 4 people suffer from mental illness in Nigeria. Very shocking, very shocking. So it's like you're on the streets and you have, you know, 3 people around you and 1 of the 4 of you like suffer from mental illness. That's quite a significant number, because that's literally 25% of the population. I assumed that, I don't know, the most recent census was sometime in maybe 2007. I don't know if I'm right or wrong. It's been a while we've done like a proper, you know, head count in Nigeria, but I used like an arbitrary number of 180 million. And that means that 45 million Nigerians suffer with mental health illnesses. And only 5%, it may be even less than that. I think I was very generous with my, you know, percentage in this case. Only about 5% present to the hospitals to seek help. The other people seek non-allopathic methods of care. What do I mean? They go to churches, they go to mosques, they visit herbalists and so on. So those are like the other ways they try to find care. And we understand why. There's a term, they call it madness. You know, this one is mad, this one is kolo. You know, even our hospital is the popular Yaba left. That's what they call it. There's already this stigmatization, you know, associated with it. So we can understand why only 5% of those people would come to, you know, doctors, you know, healthcare professionals, psychologists, and the rest to seek help, because of the stigmatization associated with mental illness. Some of the opinion that it's spiritual, majority actually of the opinion that it's spiritual. Another reason for that very low turnout in mental health facilities is because it's really, really difficult. If you've been to a government hospital before, this is, I mean, no harm trying to talk down on our system, but it is the reality, it is the truth. Going to a government hospital, you have to be there joining the queue. You're spoken to in a rude way, and so many factors, and that would make people shy away really from visiting these facilities. Next slide, please.
Sorry, there's usually a lag, and I think it's the network.
All right. So let me adjust this. Okay. So there really has been a surge, truthfully. I can go on. Can I go on?
Yes, please, you can go on.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right.
Thank you.
So recently, there's been a surge in the number of people who now visit our mental health care facilities. I mean, this is a good thing. And this is partly due to the fact that there's been increased awareness of mental illness. I mean, looking at the pre-COVID period and after COVID, like we have massive turnout of people coming to the hospitals because of one complaint or the other. It could be depression, anxiety, so many things that unfortunately COVID has brought upon us. So there's been an increase in the turnout of patients, which is a good thing. It's good that people are now knowing that actually, yes, mental illness is a real thing. It's not a myth, it is not spiritual. Next slide, please. All right. So thinking back now about my choice of discussion, I was like, I probably should have talked about something else. But anyways, everything happens for a reason. So I'll briefly talk about autism spectrum disorder. Like I said earlier, I won't bombard you guys with the medical jargon. I'll just give you a general idea of what you need to know so that, you know, when you note this, because what's the essence of all this? So that we are aware, because it's the onus is now on each and every one of us, not necessarily the healthcare professionals, to be able to spot some of these things and then recommend. This could be our church members, our relatives, our friends, children, and so on, who have these things. And because we have no idea what it is, we may not know how to help. So the idea of this is for us to at least have an idea of what this is, and we can lend a helping hand, because this is the idea of task sharing. The healthcare professionals cannot do it alone. We need people to come up to us to say, yes, this is the issue, and then we help. If people don't come, there is no way we can, you know, help them. So that is the essence of sharing this information with the general public. What is autism? So it's a spectrum, really. It's okay, before I talk about it, autism came from the Greek word, actually, like autos. Autos means like self. Auto means self. So when I go on, you understand why that's like the name autism, how the name autism came about. This is a broad term used to describe a group of neurodevelopmental conditions. What do I mean by neurodevelopmental conditions? I'll try to break the very complicated terms down. Neuro meaning the brain, and development clearly meaning development. So it's an anomaly in neurodevelopment because the brain is the one that controls so many things, so many things. If you've heard of a person who is brain dead before, they can be breathing, they can have blood flowing in their veins, you can have their heart rate still there, but once, sorry, back, once the brain is not working, like the person really cannot function. When you see people suffering from stroke, it's because there's a particular part of the brain that's not functioning. That's why they can't move a hand, they can't move a leg, they can't talk, and so on. So what happens in these children? You find out that there's some abnormality in their communication, social interaction, and it's independent on where you're from. Of course, there's a prevalence, there's a higher prevalence in boys than girls. That's about 4 to 1. But it's independent of your ethnic background, your culture, your economic background, your race. If you go to Australia, if you go to Canada, if you go to Ijebode, Badagry, anywhere, you can find a person that has autism. So it really doesn't matter who you are or where you're from. Next slide, please. Yes, so what causes autism? Why would a person, a child, have autism? There are different causes. First degree relative, just like every other illness, like hypertension. Sometimes you see that because a person's father was hypertensive, they come down with hypertension. Because a person's mother was diabetic, they come down with diabetes. This is the same for mental illness as well. You find it in people that have, not all of them, of course, but a person that has, a child that has autism, there's a possibility that they have a first degree relative that also has autism. Also genetic mutations. Genetic mutations is like a very big cause of so many illness, and autism is not excluded. Being born to older parents, I'm sure this is not news to everyone. It's not just an information that healthcare professionals have. You hear people say, I want to get married early because I don't want my child to have Down syndrome. I want to have children early because I don't want them to come down with this or that. That is because there are a lot of, you know, anomalies that comes with late maternal age, late paternal age. So being born to older parents is a risk factor for autism. Also low birth weight, children that are born at a certain kg, the normal is supposed to be between 2.5 and 3.5. But if you have below 2.5, the brain is not developed. These children usually have a lot of challenges. So there's a risk already to develop autism because the brain is not developed. Then the maternal history of viral infections. When a woman is pregnant and she has like an infection, you know, the baby is getting nutrients and everything from the placenta. The baby is also getting infections from the mother through the placenta. So there's a possibility of getting infection. It goes to the brain. That's a risk factor for autism. I'm not saying that every low birth weight child, every child born to older parents. Every child whose mother had an infection at birth would have autism. No, it is just a risk factor. Also, if fertile here means a child, like a baby that's not been born. So fertile exposure to certain medications like valproic acid, this is a drug that is just treat a certain mental illness. I don't see the need to mention it, but this medication, and if a mother is taking this drug while pregnant, there's also a risk of that child developing autism as well. There are many other causes, but I've just narrowed it down to this six. Next slide, please. Okay, so how does autism present? How do I know this child has autism? Autism is usually evident in early childhood between the ages of 12 and 24 months. That doesn't mean that it can happen earlier than 12 months and it can happen later than 24 months. What do we see? We see delay in language and social development. We see problems with communication and social interaction. We see restricted or repetitive patterns of behavioral activities. And to make a diagnosis that a person has autism, they have to experience at least one of the symptoms, either delay in language and social development, problems with communication and social interaction, restricted or repetitive patterns of behavior or activities. Next slide, please. Knowing the developmental milestones, there are certain things that should be expected at certain ages. So I'm just going to mention a few. At 6 months, you expect a child to have social smile. What do I mean by social smile? You see pictures of babies, you know, like they're smiling. Like a six-month-old child should be able to smile at a familiar face, like their mother, their siblings, their fathers. A child of a year old, at least, okay, at 9 months, a child should be able to crawl, a child should be able to do certain things. When you call them, they should be able to respond. Of course, they can't speak per se. At 12 months, you expect them to stand, not necessarily walking, because some may walk later than 12 months, but some even walk at 12 months. Some walk at 11 months, that's normal. So you expect a child to stand with support, at some point without support, you know. At 2 years, you expect them to, when you bring another child around, they should relate with that other child. They may not necessarily have like the conversation like adults, but there will be some form of communication. You can see that, oh yes, this child acknowledges the presence of this other child and is like, they are playing with toys, you know, or doing something or laughing or giggling. What happens in autism? At 9 months, you see that a child is having trouble maintaining eye contact. You call the child, let's say the child is called Dipo. You call Dipo. Dipo is his name. He's been called Dipo since he was born. Ideally, he should turn, you know, but a child not responding to his name, it means something is wrong, you know. You're tickling the child, you're, you know, waving a toy in front of the child. You expect some form of, you know, giggling, laughing. You expect emotion from this child, but this child is not showing emotions. Something is wrong. The child is, at 12 months, the child is not engaging in interactive games, not using hand gestures. You know, you call the child's name, Dipo, bye, Dipo wave back at you, but this child is just like in his own self. You know, I said autism, the word autism means self. So he's really not relating at all. At 15 months, not sharing interest with others. It has to do with also playing with other children, smiling at parents, playing with his or her siblings. At 24 months, that's 2 years already. A two-year-old child is already walking. I don't know if anyone has experienced this. Let's say for a two-year-old child, the mother is crying. You can see that the child has that, like there's that awareness that something is wrong with this person and they show it on their face. But a child that is autistic is sort of, okay, it's not intentional, but there's this indifference that you can see. At 60 months, that's 5 years old, you expect the child to, you know, engage. A child should engage with other children. The child should be playing, should be talking and everything, but they are usually by themselves, you know, not wanting to interact. Sometimes some of them even have delayed walking, delayed speaking. I think that's in the next slide. Let's go to the next one. This one got deep. Next slide, please. All right, so other things that may be present, this is just a continuation of the previous slide. Difficulty talking or limited speaking skills. You expect a five-year-old child to make, you know, normal, well, children conversation, of course, not as intellectual as an adult, but you expect them to speak, you know, they should respond, they should talk to you, but they don't talk as much. They have some of them have difficulties talking, some of them have limited speaking skills. They can, you know, hold a conversation. They have, this is a very interesting aspect of an autistic child. They have like, some of them have strong vocabulary when talking about something they're interested in. You find out that they talk, like when it comes to that aspect and they know about it, they talk about it for so long, it's even difficult to stop them. Like they go on and on and on about it. So that's like one very interesting aspect about them. But when it comes to other things, they just keep quiet. Sometimes they might talk in unusual tones. They're usually like, you know, high pitched and they go low pitched. So they have this kind of like undulating pitch when it comes to speaking. Some of them have hyperlexia. What is hyperlexia? Hyperlexia is reading beyond what is expected of your age. And then they have difficulty sharing emotions. When something is wrong with the child, when they're not pleased about something, five-year-old child can say, mommy, this is how I feel, but it's very difficult for children that have autism to do this. Yes. Next slide. I think we're coming to an end. So from the very little that I've said today, I mean, let me just backstory. Sometime in 2018, I went to see someone, a friend, and she had a nephew. I wasn't doing psychiatry at the time, and I also wasn't paying so much attention, but I noticed something. He was 2 years old at the time. He wasn't walking. I think he was standing. He had to stand with support. And he was just, you know, he would watch his cartoon. He wasn't paying attention to anyone that was around at all. A two-year-old nephew would come and disturb his aunt. That's like normal. That's natural, especially for an aunt that is not visiting for the first time. So she's really not a stranger. But he wasn't really engaging. So I told my friend, I was like, I think there's something off about your nephew. And she was like, yes, he has not talked. He has not walked. And I suggested that he was taken to, you know, a pediatrician at least to know what's going on. Well, 2 years after, she called me and she said, my nephew has autism, you know, it was so heartbreaking. Anyways, that is what it is. So from the information that I've given, I'm sure that if anyone, you know, has children around them, nephews, nieces, or even biological children, and you see something off, you know, it should come to mind, something is wrong with this child. Does this child, it could be any other thing, don't get me wrong, it doesn't necessarily have to be autism, but the most important thing is we should be aware that it's a possibility so that we can, you know, take the initiative ourselves, advise those people that are close to us, you know, take your children to this, to healthcare professionals so that they know the next step to take. Unfortunately, we really don't have medications, you know, to treat this, but there are different ways we can improve life because you don't know what you might have done for somebody. They might have been, you know, suffering in silence until, you know, took the step to say, look, I think you should take a child to see a mental health professional, because apart from the children, it's really a lot of burden. It's not easy to take care of a child that is mentally ill or even an adult or any body that is even sick. It's really a lot of burden on the relatives. So just lending that helping hand, letting them know that this is what it is, encouraging them, you know, to seek help from a professional is important. Like I said, there really is no medication, but there are so many things that can be done. A couple of months ago, I think Guarantee Trust Bank had like Autism Week, and it was very interesting. They had these children come together. They had games with them. They had talks with their parents and so many things just to make them, you know, feel loved, feel accepted, you know, encourage the caregivers. Like, it can be overemphasized. The caregivers also, like, they need to be taken into consideration. So the things that can be done is behavioral therapy, you know, talking to the children, how to behave, how to react in certain situations, play therapy. You put them amongst other children, put toys, you know, try to stimulate their brains, occupational therapy. Unfortunately, schooling might be a bit difficult, but there are so many things. A lot of people that are successful today didn't necessarily go to school. There are many things that they can learn that they can be very good at, you know. So that's where occupational therapy comes in. Speech therapy comes where you have issues, when they have issues, you know, with speaking. So we have our speech therapists coming to help them to, you know, talk, to vocalize themselves, to verbalize themselves when need be. And then physical therapy as well. Physical therapy, if there are any issues with movement, walking, you have physical therapy. In this case, to wrap it up, mental illness is not a spiritual problem. You know, there's this global mental health course I'm currently doing with the University of Washington, and when you talk about mental illness, it's different in different parts of the world. The things you see in Nigeria, you must see a different presentation in Australia, you must see a different presentation in USA, but then the core is still similar. And in our environment in Nigeria, for instance, we know that, yes, spirituality is an important part of us. There's really nothing that we can do about it. There was the idea of why can't, you know, this, what do you call them? Like the clergymen, you have the pastors, the elders work hand in hand with healthcare professionals so that they can, you know, talk to their congregation, because you would agree with me that a lot of people, we listen to our pastors, we do what they say. And it's really important that this clergy leaders know that it is not spiritual. This is mental illness, and encourage their members, visit, you know, healthcare facilities. There is the place of prayer in this case. I'm not saying the spirituality should be completely ruled out. We should walk hand in hand with these people to ensure that they get, you know, maximal care, they get everything they need. It's wrong to take them to a church and pray for them for days and make them drink so much anointing oil, or sometimes tie them and so on. I'm now speaking generally about mental illness, adults, all other forms of mental illness. You see a lot of bizarre things that are done. I mean, my eyes have seen so much in the very few months that I've spent in Federal Neuropsychiatric Hospital, Yaba. So just want to encourage us that we can do this. This is our community. Like, it's in our hands. No one is going to do it for us. So let's, you know, take that bold step to tell people with every single opportunity that we have, no knowledge is wasted. When knowledge is passed on, should also pass it to others. And I'm sure that we have, you know, a healthier generation on the long run. Thank you very much for listening.
Wow. Thank you so much, Dr. Adebimpe Gbadegesin, you know, for that wonderfully delivered lecture. It was indeed quite informative and educating, I must say. And in fact, there are some things that shocked me. The fact that one quarter, you know, that's about 25% of our population, you know, go about with mental disorder or mental health issues. It's quite shocking, really. And I just don't know what to say. Well, anyway, at this point, we need to move on, and it's going to be the question and answer session. And without any bias, if we have questions from the chat box, I'm going to be picking on one male and one female so that we can have Dr. Adebimpe Gbadegesin respond to them, to these questions. You know, we might not be able to take more than one or two because of the constraint of time as it is. We're trying to, you know, keep as much as possible to time. So I'll just be picking on one question here. I've not seen any. Do we have, okay.
I can see some. I'm like going through the chat myself.
The question's up.
I think I can answer based on the chat, right?
All right, yeah, you can. Can you read out the one you're saying so that you can, you can respond to them?
How do illiterates or the unenlightened who discover autism in their children handle it? Well, I'm not sure how I'm supposed to answer this, but I'll just try to. Okay, so what you mean is a person who really doesn't know about, is not aware of mental illness, first of all, and aware of autism. When they discover it, how do they handle it? When they discover it late, sorry, how do they handle it? I mean, they would have discovered it early, of course. They would have known that something was off, but then they would do things according to how they see, how right they think it is. They would, like those non-allopathic things that I talked about, going to mountains, tying them down, praying and all that stuff. So they would have done all this, maybe for a couple of many years. So the only thing that would change is, okay, they now know it's autism, and they know the next, for them to have discovered it, they probably have presented in a healthcare facility. So it means that they will just get the right care that they need rather than what had been done before they discovered that, okay, this is mental illness. I don't know if I've answered your question. If I haven't, you can just call my attention to it. Type in.
Okay.
So from Ademola Oyebode, is mental health hereditary, especially schizophrenia? Okay. Like I said in the beginning, just like hypertension, diabetes, some form of mental illnesses also occur because a relative has it, and schizophrenia is not exempted. Let me see if I remember. Okay, for instance, if you have twins, that's the ones that look alike, the monozygotic twins. If one has a mental illness, the percentage of, there's a 46% chance of his twin or her twin also having a mental illness. If a brother has a mental illness, I think there is a 1% chance of the other sibling also having a mental illness. If a parent has a mental illness, I think there's a 16% chance of the child having a mental illness. So yes, it is actually, it can be hereditary. And sometimes you see some patients who have mental illness, and when you ask about the family history, is there anyone that has a mental illness in your family? They say no. That's because they don't know, you know, because you can't really, partly because they won't tell you, you know, they might hide that kind of information. So a person won't even know that their family member had a form of mental illness. It could be schizophrenia, it could be depression, it could be bipolar affective disorder. So yes, it is hereditary. That's why when we see two people who have mental illnesses wanting to even get married, we counsel them extensively because there's a possibility that they would have a child with mental illness. And that doesn't, we are not saying do not get married, but just let them know that this is something that they may have to prepare for if the marriage is compulsory, because you have the choice to, okay, say no, just to reduce the risk of, because if it's one person, one parent, the risk is reduced, but if it's both parents, the risk is increased. So yes, mental illness is hereditary, even depression, even the use of alcohol, the excessive use of alcohol that causes a lot of mental and behavioral disorders, it can also be hereditary. In grandparents, you find out that grandchildren are drinking excessively because it's a family history. A grandparent or a parent was using alcohol. Apart from seeing them, there's the genetic part of that as well.
Okay. Okay. All right. I think I'll just allow you to take one more question before we draw, you know, the curtain on question and answers. Just go ahead and take one more.
Bring down. Okay, I think this is the same question. Okay, I think the last question is the only question left anyway. So my question for the autism presentation is, one, medically, can the exact cause of autism in a child be determined? So when you look at medicine holistically, for things like hypertension, most times actually, we know why a person has hypertension. There are so many factors that would cause hypertension. When a person has malaria, you know that, yes, this person has been infected by, has been bitten by a mosquito, this, the causative organism, the trophozoite has gotten blood, so you know what has caused it. So I'm not sure if you were there from the beginning, but if you were, you'd see that I talked about risk factors. So a medical cause, exactly, is really, you can't really pinpoint what must have, but they are risk factors. I mentioned quite a number of them, like a child that is born, you know, below 2.5 kg, a child that is born to parents that are elderly, a child that has a first degree relative that has autism, a child that had that was born to a mother that had an infection in utero, that's while in the womb, a child that was born to a mother taking a certain medication like valproic acid. So really, there are so many risk factors. And you know, sometimes you can use risk factors and causes interchangeably, but to say that there is an X cause of autism, no, we can't say that. So your second, sorry, this is a 2-in-1 question, and this is the last question. Is there a possibility for a child undergoing therapy outgrow autism, or the child will normally live with it? You don't outgrow autism, you know. So that is why we have all these things that I listed: the behavioral therapy, speech therapy, occupational therapy, and play therapy. So all these things are just to, you know, support these children to, like, to make the quality of their lives better. So you don't outgrow autism. I think that's the last question.
All right. Thank you so much, Doctor. So, you know, it's been so, you know, educating, like I said. And I'm sure by now a whole lot of us are more informed, you know, about what autism is, you know, what autism is all about and how we can actually, you know, give support to autistic people. You know, it's been quite a very great session with you. Thank you so much. At this point, we'll be coming to the end of the first lecture. And I wish I can request that we give a resounding applause to Dr. Gbadegesin for this great honor. Thank you so much. Okay, so we'll just be moving on to the next program. And to anchor this, I'll be calling on Mr. Ademola Oyebode to please lead us into the next program. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Mr. Fuja. Good afternoon, everybody. It's been very informative so far. I've learned a thing or two or more things about mental health. Before I continue, I'd just like to quickly remind us that the foundation or the goal for this particular organization is to create awareness about child mental health and personal finance, financial wellness, and allow people to key into this vision. We want people to know more about mental health. A lot of people don't know about mental health. In fact, it is not talked about. If I look back, I think between last year and this year, there's been a high rise in information dispersal on mental health because it's becoming more of an issue. And so this is one of the reasons why this has been set up. I'll quickly say that I'll just put a little humor into what I'm trying to say. My neighbor was telling me some days ago that he was in traffic along VGC Road. He was just driving home, you know, after a whole day's work. And he took his glass down. I don't know what he was thinking of. Maybe he was tired of the ACO. And someone just slapped him from the... So, you know, and he was confused, you know, innocently. Just immediately, I mean, just took it back up and said, let me just continue enjoying my... You know, I'm saying that as a joke, but that's to tell you, especially in Lagos, there are a lot of people that are mentally ill and nobody knows what's happening. So it's really important for us to, you know, pay attention to this and that's why we want to educate people. I mean, on child, I was reading stuff on statistically, WHO says that worldwide about 10% of children and adolescents experience mental disorder. Now, from this 10%, 50% of mental health conditions actually start at age 14. So that's to say that any display you see now in an adult man, it probably started a long time ago. So it is very important that we pay attention to our kids and people around us. We'll go ahead to do a lot of interventions in the future, and I hope you can key into it with all of us. You can follow any one of our social media handles. We have that for Instagram. It was just posted on the screen, but I'll just say it again. For Instagram, we have Instagram and Facebook is, so it's on the screen again. Instagram and Facebook is BF Toye Foundation. If you want to send us an email or even questions, you can reach us at info@bftoyefoundation.org. You know, our website is www.bftoyefoundation.org. Please reach out to us and then so we can partner together and make this information. And then you can also to be informed about future projects that are coming. We have a lot of projects that are coming, and please check our websites continuously, and you get very much good information on that. Just so we could quickly, let's just test our brains a little bit. You know, I would like to post something on the screen. As soon as you get it, please just reply on the chat box, say, I got it. I'll post something on the screen, it's going to appear shortly. As soon as you get it, please just write, I got it on the chat box. Then the first person that gets it will eventually tell us what he or she understands by it. So Joshua, please go ahead. So there's something on the screen, on the shirt. Okay, someone has gotten it already. Any other person? Please, if you've gotten it. Okay. That's fast. Do we see how people getting it? If you've not gotten it now, let's talk to doctor. We have to get it. You know. Okay, thank you very much. I will allow the first person. Oh no, I can see Ebola here. If she gets it, then I'll allow her to see what it is. Ebola is. If you've gotten it, Ebola, please unmute and tell us what it is.
Intelligence is the ability to adapt to change.
Wow, that's wonderful.
Stephen of Hawkins.
Wow.
That's fantastic. Thank you very much, Ebola. All right, that's good. That was just to jolt us a little bit. And someone has written it also. Intelligence is the ability to adapt to change. You forgot to add adapt there. Well, that's fantastic. Thank you very much. No. Ebola got it. Ebola got it. Someone wrote on the chat box. Intelligence, the ability to change. Not Ebola. Ebola got it. All right, people. Without further ado, I would like to introduce the next keynote speaker. With a lot of experience, and he'll be talking to us on the least traveled world route. His name is Mr. Anthony Chukwurah. He is the CEO of bestshopng.com. You can find him on www.bestshopng.com. He's a financial empowerment and wealth creation expert. Mr. Chukwurah has trained over 4,000 Nigerians to start different profitable businesses from scratch. So that's to tell you that if you want to start a business, or if you have a business that you want to scale up, this is the right place to be. And he owns one of the largest wholesale bedding e-commerce platform in Nigeria. So, I mean, people pay for this, but we are going to have it here and we're going to enjoy ourselves. So please, let's put our hands together as we invite Mr. Anthony Chukwurah to take the stage.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is indeed a privilege to be here today. I am so blessed by the first speaker. Honestly, I am blown away. A lot of information that we need to have that we don't have at the moment. You know, all through my life, I've always believed that mental health has to do with, you know, spiritual problem. So, but the doctor has broken that jinx today. I'm so excited. I'm very happy to be here. I believe we are having a wonderful time together. I want to appreciate the organizers of this great event. Indeed a privilege. The slogan of this foundation, that's Bandele and Folasade Toye Foundation, it came at the right time. When we see the rate at which our youth of nowadays are behaving, the rate at which they are pursuing money, the rate at which secret cultism is increasing, drug abuse. When I look at all these things, I imagine what our country, Nigeria, will be like in the next 15, 20 years. Because these youths that are behaving this way are the same youth that we call leaders of tomorrow. So I really appreciate what this foundation is doing. When I saw the slogan, making a better you, being healthy and being wealthy, I know that this is just what this nation, and not just this nation, the whole world needs at this point in time. We need people to educate us, we need people to encourage the youth, encourage everybody on how to live better life. Once again, I appreciate each and every one of us, and I thank you for giving me the opportunity to share my thoughts on the topic, the least troubled world. Wealth building is a topic that has been, you know, it's not new to the world. Tens of thousands of books have been written on wealth building. Some of us here have read one or two books or articles that talked about wealth building. So to us, wealth building is not a new phenomenon. Wealth building has been there for ages. Many of us actually have a preconceived notion of how to build wealth, even though we may not have read anything about wealth building, but we've always had this belief, we've always had this notion in our head that yes, we are going to make it. We are going to retire wealthy. We are going to be very successful. Okay, we've always had, many of us, we have it at the back of our minds that we are going to make it. But are we really going to make it? Wealth building is not something that one can achieve by wishful thinking. There has to be a calculated strategy, well planned out and executed. But to us, it seems so easy. So many of us are coming from the background whereby we've had several testimonies, you know, from maybe our churches, or we read, or we listened to videos of, you know, somebody coming out to testify of how broke, how poor he or she was for many years, and then on coming to the church, the daddy in the Lord or mommy in the Lord lay hands on him. He attended this program, and suddenly the next week he went out and met something. Something happened, and he or she experienced financial breakthrough. So many of us have listened, and we believe that, you know, we want such to be our own fate as well. We kept praying, and we are going to experience our own fate. so many people want to, you know, we love this dividend of hard work, meaning people are not willing to work hard. When you look at what is going on among our youth today, Yahoo has defrauding people here and there. Many people have come to see it as a profession. I know about a woman that was explaining, that was, you know, complaining to me about his son, he has told his son that Yahoo is not for everybody, that he can go and look for something better to do. Why this woman was complaining, I was looking at this woman. She's talking about as something that is normal. Yahoo is not favoring my son. I'm asking him to go. She is not condemning what the son is doing, but she is just telling me that the Yahoo is not favoring the son, and she is trying to encourage the son to go and start something new. That is the type of society that we are living in right now. And I wonder where all this is taking us to. So I'm very happy that this foundation have come to tackle this menace in our society. Wealth building is possible. We all can attend to being wealthy in life. Yes, we all can achieve that. But there is need for us to have a well planned out and calculated step strategies on how to actualize that dream. When we were in school, we have these imaginations in our head. We have this dream that when we graduate from school, you know, we get a good job, or we land going to a new business, we start making money, okay, rent lovely apartment, you know, get married, buy our car, and then we live happily thereafter. Those are the type of dreams we used to have when we were school. I strongly believe that some of us, we have these imaginations. We had these dreams when we were in school then. But when we come into the world, we discover that it's a different ball game. It's a different ball game. There are steps to take. There are rules to becoming financially free. There are rules to becoming or to retiring wealthy. I believe that by the end of this session, we may go home with one or two things that will assist us as we walk towards our worldly destination. Because of time constraints, I'm going to skip a lot of slides. And I want us to get to the fifth slide, the three financial classes of people in the world. Because of time constraint, okay? The other ones are important, but then that should be a topic for another day. We have three financial classes of people in the world. Three financial classes of people in the world. We have the poor class. And this poor class constitute about 70% of the world population. And then, according to Forbes, the poor class are those that earn less than $25,000 per annum. 5,000 naira per annum, when you convert it to Nigerian, $25,000 when you convert it is about 13 point something million naira annually. Those are the people that Forbes, according to their own research, categorize as the poor. And then we have the middle class. The middle class constitutes about 25% of the population. And these are people that earn, according to Drum Major Institute, these are people that earn from $25,000 to $100,000 annually. And then we have the wealthy class. These are the three financial classes of people we have in the world today. I don't know the class you belong to. I don't know if going by the statistics that they have given to us, you know the class you belong to, the financial class you belong to at the moment. It's very important that we know the financial class we belong to, because that will help us to get to the next level. Okay? that will help us to get to the next level. It's good for us to be challenged. For those of us that may be thinking that they are about to hit their wealthy status, when you look at the statistics I just mentioned, then you know whether you're getting closer or not. But it's good to know that. Okay, and then the fact is that we don't need to beat ourselves. If you happen to see yourself that we are in the poor class, you don't need to beat yourself, because majority of the people who are in the wealthy class graduated from the poor class to the wealthy class. Now, when you look at these three classes of people that are mentioned, you agree with me that they have one thing in common. There is something each of them have in common, and that is they all make money. The poor class make money, the middle class make money, the wealthy also make money. So each of these three financial classes of people make money. If all of them make money, then what is the problem? The challenge is in what each of them do with their money. What each of them do with their money is what makes the difference in their life. That is what determines how and where they will end up. What they do with their money. Now, let's talk about how the poor spend their money. Because everybody earns money. Even the beggar on the street earns money as well. Everybody earns money. But how do you spend the money that enters your hand? Let us take a closer look on how the poor class spend their money. First of all, the poor, they buy things they don't need. People in the poor class, they buy things they don't need. They buy things probably because it's cheaper. They decide to go for it. Wow. They are selling this product a certain amount in this particular area, but here they are selling that amount. It's better I don't miss this opportunity. They decide to buy, even when they don't need it. They buy things because a salesperson have sweet-tongued them, okay, introduce a product to them, and then, you know, tell them sweet things about the product, how fantastic the product is, and then maybe give them a discount and a deadline, and suddenly they decide to jump on it. So people in the poor class buy things they don't need. Okay? And that is part of the ways they waste their money. That is part of the ways they spend the money that enters into their hands. Again, people in the poor class, they invest in businesses and investments that are unrealistic. You see someone putting his money into a business that probably someone has told them, you put 20,000 or 50,000 naira into this business, and in the next 6 months, you're making 10 million naira. Or you see someone paying money to someone. Let's say you have a laptop that sells for 200,000 naira and someone is offering it to someone for 40,000 naira. And you know the value. They quickly pay money. And at the end of the day, they are duped. So the poor class are fond of putting their money into businesses and investments that promise so huge return on investment with small amount of money. That is another way the poor waste their money and spend their money. Yes, they want to be wealthy just like the rest of us. Everybody wants to be wealthy. But the plan or the ways or the means of getting to that wealthy destination is what we don't know. And we are not aware of it. I believe after today, we'll go home with something that is going to assist us if indeed we aspire to retire wealthy. So the poor person earns money and keep wasting their money on, you know, frivolities, things that are not realistic. The poor class also, they put a lot of money into lotteries. They believe in overnight success. They believe, well, one day I'm just going to hit it by chance. I'm not against that. I'm not disputing the fact that miracles happen and people, you know, Bible said that time and chance happen to them all. You know, it's all about, you know, we've had stories of people who by chance, you know, meet an opportunity that transform their lives and transform their finances. We know that. But while we are praying and, you know, believing God for such breakthrough, let's first of all start gradually by walking, taking the steps that will take us to that, you know, required wealthy retirement. So the poor people spend money on things they don't just need. Someone was making a joke and said, in Nigeria, they said there is no money. Everybody's complaining of hardship. There's no money, there's no money. But when you go to ATM, you see long queues. What are they withdrawing? Is it money? Is it not money they are withdrawing there? So everybody makes money. Though people are complaining, people are earning a lot of money. But what makes the difference, as I said before, is in what we do with the money that enters our hands. So that is, these are part of the ways that the poor person spends the seed capital or the money that enters into their hands. And at the end of the day, so many of them are not able to migrate or graduate from that poor class into the wealthy class. That is the reality of it. What about the middle class? The middle class make much more money than the poor people, than the poor class. But they have the same spending habit with the poor. Yes, they have the same spending habit, only that this time they spend much more. They spend money on luxury items. They spend money on luxury cars, jewelries. They spend money on, you know, lovely things, flashy, designer wares. Designer wear, jewelries, very expensive wares. Now I'm talking about the middle class. Waste a lot of money. They send their children to very expensive schools. Not just because the schools are expensive, not just because of the things they learn in those schools, but probably so that, you know, they will belong. So the poor class and the middle class have the same spending habit. They are victims of their spending habit. We must have, you know, come in contact with people like that, or must have known, you know, you said that this person was very rich, you know, the way, the type of lifestyle he or she was living, but, you know, today is nowhere to be found. That is the middle class. We have a lot of celebrities like that. We've heard of so many of them that died broke, that died poor, despite living very, you know, luxurious lifestyle, living very, you know, many of them are very popular. They are well known. They are big boys. They go to clubs. They are being hailed because they are known as big boys and big girls. They spend a lot of money. So this is part of the way that the middle class spend their money. They spend their money on liabilities, things that do not produce interest, things that do not yield money. So at the end of the day, middle class people end up poor. Okay, at the end of the day, so many middle class people end up poor, just like the poor person. But does it mean that there are no chances for the middle class and the poor to graduate to the wealthy class? Of course, there are a lot of chances. for the fact that both of them are victims of their, you know, spending habits, it's always difficult for them to graduate to the wealthy class. Okay, now the wealthy, how do they spend their money? Of course, the wealthy, they also make expenses. They do expenses, they spend money too. And like the poor and the middle class, but this time around, they are very conscious of what they spend money on. And mind you, when I'm talking about the wealthy, I'm not talking about people who are already wealthy. As Napoleon Hill always said, that wealth is a state of mind. There are some people, they are not yet there, but when you come in contact with them, you know that this person, you know where this person is going to. They are not moved by frivolities. They don't invest or put their money in lotteries, football bettings, like the poor and the middle class do. They are not moved by businesses that yield high interest with small amounts of money. You present a business proposal to them, they look at it, they think critically about it. Sometimes they make consultation before knowing whether to go in or not. The same applies to what they spend their money on. They calculate, they think about what they spend their money on. The wealthy invest their money in assets. They put their money where their money will yield more money for them. And as their asset acquires more, continue to yield more money, they acquire more assets. And when the income from their asset grows greater, becomes greater than their expenses, they become financially free. These are well-calculated steps that people who want to become wealthy, who want to retire wealthy in life, steps that they need to take to get to that level. What we do with our money right now matters a lot. What we do with our money right now matters a lot. So henceforth, let us be mindful that this money that is coming into our hands, no matter how small it is a seed capital that God is making available for us to get to the next level, for us to retire, for us to end well, because I believe that is what this foundation stands for. Making a better you, being healthy, retiring wealthy. When you look around you today, we see, while we look around us today, we see a lot of old men, old women who are still poor. Does it mean that these people were not as young as we were? They were very young. And when they were young, they were not lazy. Many of them were working hard just like the rest of us. But today, so many of them end up poor. So what is the guarantee that as we are working hard today and we are hopeful that tomorrow we are going to retire wealthy, what is the guarantee that we are going to actualize that dream? It has to do with what we do with the money that enters our hands today. So what are we going to do? The next slide, please. What do we do? What do we do to help ourselves get to this financial wealthy retirement? There's this old principle that has stood the test of time, and that is the advice and encouragement that we should pay ourselves first. Pay yourself first. It might sound so easy, but it is not very easy. It's a very difficult practice. And that is one of the key reasons why so many people are not retiring wealthy. Pay yourself first. We make money. We spend money on clothing. We spend money on different things, different commitments. We belong to different groups and we spend money on these groups. Everything, we have a lot of commitments here and there. We help our aging parents, we help our siblings. We end up paying every other person but ourselves. So friends, You know, the Bible says something that we should love our neighbors as ourselves. But in practice, we love our neighbors but ourselves. Actually, we think we are doing the right things we are supposed to do, but we are neglecting ourselves. And why we do that is because maybe we don't know that that small amount of money that we're able to save, that we're able to set aside to save and invest, not just to save and invest, that is the money that will make us wealthy. That is the money that will help us to retire wealthy in life. So it's very important. No matter how much we are earning, we can save. It might be difficult, it might seem difficult, but it takes a lot of discipline. If you earn 100,000 naira on a monthly basis, for example, and you are managing yourself, living off the proceeds of the 100,000, you and your family, the chances are that you can also survive with 95,000 naira or even 90,000 naira. If your boss comes to you today and say, please, business is not moving smoothly. We want to adjust, we want to reduce your salary from 100,000 naira to 90,000 naira. Please bear with us. Are you going to resign? Of course not. You also adjust yourself to manage that 90,000 naira with you and your family. So if that is the case, that means we need to stretch ourselves. We need to stretch ourselves to save a portion of, no matter how small, even if it's 5,000 every month, set it aside and invest it. That is the money that will make us to retire wealthy. There's an adage in Igbo land that says, the money you make from working hard, that is all the money you make from working hard is meant for food. Okay, is no matter how much you earn, and we cannot earn enough. Sorry, we cannot earn enough. The one that is earning 100,000 naira is complaining. The one earning 500,000 on monthly basis is complaining. The one earning 1 million naira on monthly basis is equally complaining. 5 million is complaining as well. Why? Because the bigger you are, the bigger the headache you have. No amount of income that we are earning that will be enough for us if we don't discipline ourselves to save, to remove part of it, set it aside for investment. No amount of money. Because as our wealth grows or as our income grows, so does our desire grow to meet up with that income. If you're earning 100,000 naira, you know that there are some clothes you can't afford. You know where you go to buy a cracker. You know what a cracker is. You know a particular place where you buy quality ones. That when you wear it, your colleagues and your friends will be, man, wow, this is good. You know where to buy a cracker, shirts, trousers, or, you know, gown and skirt and also shoes. You're managing that income that you are earning. But as time goes on, by the time you start earning 300,000, your mind will start telling, ah, man, all these people that are even wearing this, that go to this particular boutique or go to this place to buy all these designers, they have two heads. Okay, my status is changing. Even if you want to live frugal lifestyle, even if you want to continue with the lifestyle you're living, your spouse might think otherwise. He or she will remind you, why are we still living like this? Now we don't pass this level. So it's always challenging. As our income is growing, so does our desire to spend more money. So it's all about one, making out, you know, disciplining him or herself to save a portion of his or her income. I was so shocked that I met a policeman, not a very high-ranking policeman, because I met him in a filling station. He was the one in charge of that filling station, guarding that filling station. And the man happened to be a Christian, you know, a principled man. And he told me that he never collected bribe as a police officer. And in the course of our discussion, the man was telling me the number of properties he had in Ikorodu, in some other places. I was shocked. And what is his secret? He lives below his means and is able to, you know, struggle and struggle and struggle, and was able to acquire some of these properties. So the amount of money we are earning at the moment, whether we find ourselves in the poor class, the middle class, and let me not mention middle class, we find ourselves in the poor class, that doesn't mean that one will remain at that middle class. The possibility of we getting to, you know, the retiring wealthy is very high. So it's very important that we save part of our money, invest it, and when you invest it, you are investing it. Let's say, for example, you buy shares. You save 10,000 naira, you buy shares of First Bank with 10,000 naira, and you are busy working hard, you're busy struggling with what you're doing. As you're working hard, generating income for you and your family, your business, your money out there is busy generating more money for you. Professionals in First Bank, they are busy working hard, generating more money for you. So you are working, other people are working for you as well. And that is the idea behind people saying that your money is out there working for you. And that money you're setting aside that is working for you, that is the money that will make you rich. That is the money that will help us to retire wealthy. Next slide, please. It's very important. No matter how small it is, by the time you start seeing the dividend, it will amaze you. By the time you start seeing the dividend of this small amount you are setting aside, it will blow your mind. If you are saving 10,000 naira every month, at the end of the year, you must have saved about 120,000 naira. That 120,000 naira, you put it in an investment. When you put it into an investment, you know, it stays there for another year. Even if it's an investment, that generates 10% interest per annum. Like Robert Allen will say in his book, Multiple Streams of Income, he said that, you know, for one to retire wealthy, that the things that are required is your ability to identify an investment that can generate at least 10% interest after tax annually. And then the discipline to keep up the progress year in, year out. Identify an investment that you're putting your money is generating income for you. And then when that income is multiplied, when it generates that income, the next year, okay, it's compounding. That is where the power of compounding comes in. The power of compounding is magical. It's magical. When you put your money in an instrument that generates 10% interest annually, if it's 120,000, for example, let me use 100,000, which is a whole, you know, a whole sum. At the end of the year, your investment has generated additional 10,000 naira profit interest. Okay, that 10,000 naira interest, that means your capital has grown to 110,000. That 110,000 is reinvested the next year. And at the end of the year, you earn 10% of 110,000. That is also reinvested. By the time you run it for 10 years, by the time you run it for 15 years, you will be amazed at the type of result that you're going to get. All we need is patience. Rome was not built in a day. When you look at the analogy, when you look at the data, the analysis I gave here, although I used 25% interest rate on investment of 120,000 naira being invested annually. 120,000 naira being invested annually at investment yield return on investment of 15% per annum. That was what I used to do the analysis I made here. I discovered that at the end of 15 years, that investment have grown to about 15 point something million naira. That is the power of compounding. Friends, when you save money, put it in the bank, one day you'll be tempted to go and, you know, dip your hand in. Of course, that temptation is always there because our desires, it doesn't end, it doesn't stop. It keeps magnifying on daily basis. And if you are just saving money in the bank, you are just wasting your money. If you save 120,000 naira in 15 years, you know how much you're going to get? If you just save 120,000, 120,000 times 10, you're talking about 1.2 million, right? And then 15 is not up to 2 million naira. But if you're investing it carefully, compounding your interest, in the next 15 years, we are talking about 15 point something million. And friends, I want to tell you that when it comes to wealth building, you grow your money to a certain level, suddenly you become wealthy. Because you grow your money to a certain level, then from there, you can take part of the money, invest in real estate. Okay? From there, you see yourself, you give yourself extra 5 years. And people that know you won't know you, won't recognize you again. But it takes patience. It takes determination. Many of us in this 21st century are very impatient. When you tell the person in the next 10 years, 15 years, it seems like an unattainable goal. But how old are you going to be in the next 10 years? How old are you going to be in the next 20 years? Look around you. Are there people who are of that age that you're going to be in the next 15 years who are poor? If yes, that means if care is not taken, one might end up just like them. If you don't take your time and carefully set out, you know, small amount of money on monthly basis. I'm talking out of experience. I'm not retired yet. But it blows your mind when you discipline yourself. Okay, it gets to a point that anytime you miss that investment, anytime you miss removing such amount of money for, you know, investment, you feel sick.
Anthony, sorry to cut you.
I'm rounding off. I should round up.
Yes, please. We are taxed for time. You can round up in 2 minutes. Thank you.
Okay, I'm rounding up. I'm actually at the last slide.
Thank you very much.
I want to encourage us, okay? As we are aspiring to retire wealthy, to form this habit of saving small amount of our wealth, small amount of our income, because that is the money that will make us wealthy in life. Thank you very much for your audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Anthony. Thank you. This was a lot. This power of compound interest, it speaks a lot. It speaks volumes, because many times we don't know how much savings compound. This is a reminder. If you don't start, you can never finish, and it's time to start making decisions to save money and for it to compound. So thank you very much, Mr. Anthony. I'm going to open the floor for questions right now. Anybody with questions, please. I can see Samuel Okwemi John with his hands up.
No, it's a mistake. He's not able to bring it down.
Okay. Anybody with a question? All right. If we don't have any questions right now. I'd like to thank Anthony once more. I'd like to say here that whatever questions we have, I think there's questions that have been sent to our email. We would get the questions across to either one of the speakers and then we'll revert back with the answers to as many questions have come in. So thank you very much. At this point, I'd like to invite Mrs. Adejoke Ogunstonwu, both of them.
A profound gratitude goes to God Almighty for making this event a success. A big thank you to our guest speakers for the knowledge shared with us. To every attendee, thank you for honoring us with your presence at the launch. We believe that we will follow and participate in future activities of the Bandele and Folasade Toye Foundation. We are thankful to everyone involved in the planning and implementation of today's event. God bless you all, and thank you.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. And with that vote of thanks from Adijoke, we shall be coming to the end of this very unique event. And I'm sure by now we are all better informed than before. And we'll be going with a whole lot of knowledge and wisdom. Time for prayers, and with that, we'll be drawing the curtain, you know, of this event. Please, can we be in the prayer mode? We thank the Almighty God for making this day a reality. We thank Him for life. We thank Him for keeping us to come together to share knowledge and wisdom. We pray to the Almighty God that everything we have learned today shall be to the improvement of, you know, our society. That we pray. We pray that as we go back to our various lifestyle, our various works, our various homes, that the God continue to be with us, that He continue to guide and guide our dealings. In the name of the Almighty God, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you all for coming around, and we sincerely appreciate this.
Amen.
We hope to see you some other time, and we hope when we call on you, you shall be here. Thanks.
Thank you.
Amen.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Congratulations, Grandpa.